Chapter 1661. Nolase was stunned, lowered his gaze, and let off a sudden chuckle after a while. Is it because of me? He then leaned forward and moved half an inch closer to her. Then do tell me, what did I do to upset you? Daisy dodged his gaze and looked away.
I heard that.
Lisa tried to seduce you last night. Nolase stared at her as if he did not expect her to be angry because of this, and she clearly looked very jealous. He smiled.
Do you mind this?
How can I not mind that? You're my boyfriend, and she's already done that to you, even I haven't. Daisy forced the remaining sentence that almost blurted out back down her windpipe. What I wanted to say is that even I haven't done it to him yet. But how can I have such an outrageous idea? If Nolase were to know about this, he would definitely think that I'm a promiscuous and horny lady. Nolase looked at her fixedly.
What have you not done?
She hurriedly changed her words.
I haven't.
I haven't even entered your bedroom, but she actually went in.
Oh.
Nolase raised his eyebrows, and his smirk intensified. Do you want to come into my bedroom?
I
can at least take a look, can't I? Daisy pushed him away immediately. Let's not talk about this now. Judging from what Lisa did in front of you last night, you must have seen every inch of her body, haven't you? She was so cute that Nolase could not help but burst into laughter.
How are you still laughing?
Daisy was truly exasperated. He reached out and brought her into his arms.
But I didn't see anything.
You're lying.
I'm not lying.
Nolase held her hand and pecked her fingertips. It was her business when she chose to take off her clothes, but it doesn't mean that I'm obliged to take a look at her after she's done so. I don't plan to go to an ophthalmologist tomorrow. But Freya told me that you guys won't refuse any girl who takes the initiative to throw herself on you unless. Nolase looked at her.
Unless what?
Unless your package doesn't work. As soon as Daisy said so, she lowered her head, and the sudden awkwardness that permeated the atmosphere made her wish to bury herself in a hole at that instant. I haven't said anything wrong, have I? Nolase lifted her chin and questioned her with a serious tone. Are you saying that I can't do it? Her gaze was drifting all over the place.
I'm not the one who said that.
Nolase leaned forward, and his lips were pressed against the side of her cheek as he whispered something into her ear. Daisy's cheeks turned extremely warm and flushed, and she panicked.
I'm not the one who said that, you bully.
Nolase held her in his arms, hugged her tightly, buried his face in her hair, and laughed.
So, do you still want to question me?
She froze in his arms and shook her head, not daring to say anything anymore. Nolase's fingertips stopped on her earlobe as he lowered his head and stared at her face, which looked as flushed as a tomato.
I won't fall for another woman other than you.
Daisy clenched the placket of his shirt. She had always found his attitude toward her very difficult to resist. He then sent Daisy back to the Hilton Villas and watched her enter the villa before asking Edison to drive away. Edison received a call and then handed the phone to the rear of the car. It was a call from the bodyguard. Nolase answered the call, "What's the matter?" The bodyguard reported to him, "Young master, the hospital just called and claimed that Miss Fraser just went to visit Miss Reese in the afternoon." Nolase looked out the window and asked deeply, "Really?
Ms.
Reese has been disfigured, and her family is in deep trouble. It's only natural for her to feel extremely unreconciled with the incident. So perhaps she might choose to lend Lisa a helping hand. Getting hold of what happened to Lara and sowing discord between her and Daisy behind her back would be a piece of cake for Lisa. Lara had gotten used to acting arrogant and ordering others around because of her family background. And the sudden downfall of her family had caused her to lose all the prestige that she had been enjoying all her life. Not many people would be able to withstand that blow. The bodyguard asked, "Then what do you plan to do?" It seems that the person supporting her from behind is her final bargaining chip, but she won't take the initiative to contact that person until things look really bad for her. Nolase leaned into the back of the rear seat,
and after a few seconds of pause, his gaze turned dim and stern. It's time to contact Mr. Matthews. Chapter 1662. At the hospital. A figure appeared at the door after Lisa left the ward. Lara was sitting on the edge of the bed, and her gaze looked dim until the moment she heard footsteps approaching. She turned around and could not help but ask warily, "Who are you?" The man smiled. "Young Master Knowles asked me to tell you that he can let things slide this time around." Lara was surprised and astonished for a split second, but she then sneered. "Do you think I'll need him to let me go now? I've lost everything now, so I'm not afraid of anyone." Those who had lost everything would have nothing else to lose, so she had nothing to worry about at this moment. The man approached her. "Ms. Reese, do you know Mr. Matthews?" Donald Matthews, it was impossible for Lara not to know this name. He was a man who had managed to make all women in Yarramore feel afraid. "This man, Donald Matthews, invited me to dinner several times, but I rejected all of them because I knew the reason behind all his invitations. But it might be due to my family background and the status that I was able to reject him without any consequences. Donald didn't dare to coerce me because of my family. However, things are different now." Lara's expression changed slightly. "What do you mean by that?" "Mir. Matthew said he wouldn't mind your luck." Lara could not help but shiver. Her face was as pale as death. The man continued. "You're also aware of Mr. Matthews's personality and fetish. Things won't end well for any woman who falls into his hands. So, will you be willing to do that to yourself?" She trembled violently. "Are you threatening me?" "Don't take this as a threat, but a chance for you." The man turned on his phone and placed Lisa's photo in front of her. "You should know this girl quite well by now." Lara fell silent in an instant. "This girl has come to me twice, and she also has grudges with the daughter of the Goldmans. But I didn't expect Nala's men to know about our encounters." After a moment of silence, she bit her lip. "What do you want me to do?" "Mr. Matthews will invite you to dinner the day after tomorrow, and you must be there." Before Lara could refuse that invitation, the man added, "Do bring this girl along." At the Knowles Mansion study. When the bodyguard returned and reported the outcome of his conversation with Lara, there was no doubt that Lara agreed to the suggestion. Knowles tapped his fingertips on the desk and gave off a scoff as if he was not surprised by Lara's compromise. "Lara is afraid of Donald. There are quite a few women whose lives have been destroyed by Donald in the past. Now that she's lost her family background, she has no way of rejecting him. The chance that I'm giving Lara is to let her choose her own path, whether she wants to live or die. Donald knows that Lara has been disfigured and has already lost interest in her, but that doesn't mean that he would let her go. He's not reconciled to the fact that he wasn't able to own her back then." The bodyguard looked at him. "Young master, are you sure Donald will take a fancy to Lisa?" Knowles laughed. "Lisa's the one who will fall for him." The bodyguard was startled. "Donald is 34 years old but has already gotten 3 divorces at such a young age. He has severe violent tendencies, which makes him quite a psychopath. Any woman who knows his true colors avoids him as if he's the devil. He looks rather handsome, but what's hidden underneath his well-mannered shell is a bloodthirsty soul. Didn't his second and third wives get bewitched by his appearance too and chose to marry him in the end? Lisa got kicked out of the Knowles and should be very desperate at the moment. If she were to get to meet Donald, she wouldn't let go of the chance to cling to him. When a woman has degenerated to the extent she will put her body forward as the first offer when she wants something in exchange, she's abandoned her sense of humiliation. So since Lisa can't stop trying to climb up the social ladder, why don't we give her a nudge in the correct direction?" A few days later, Lara received Donald's invitation again. Looking at the invitation letter in her hand, she took out her cell phone and contacted Lisa. She even took the initiative to buy her one of the most expensive and beautifully customized evening gowns Yarramore had to offer. After listening to Lara's introduction of the man who could help her on her journey, Lisa could not wait to dress up and attend the dinner with Lara. Chapter 1663. Lara wore a wide hat, covering half of her face, which was wrapped in bandages. She had not recovered from her injuries, and when she was discharged from the hospital, her entire face was still rather inflamed and bloated. Compared to Lisa, who was dressed in an extremely vibrant and glamorous dress, Lara could not look any more ordinary. In the past, she would not allow any other woman to look more gorgeous than her and snatch all attention from her at a party or banquet. But she could only hope she had made herself ugly enough tonight. The waiter brought them to a private room, and the two men waiting outside the private room pushed the door open for them. The man sitting in the private room was wearing a blue suit. He had a profound facial profile, a well-built figure, a typical aquiline nose, and a pair of blue, stern-looking eyes. He poured a glass of red wine, took a sniff from the glass, and said in a hoarse voice, "I've invited you out for dinner many times before, and you're finally willing to give me a chance this time around." Others might not understand what he meant, but Lara could instantly get his sarcasm. She clenched her palms subconsciously and walked up to the dining table. Donald took a glance at Lisa. "Miss Reese, you even brought a friend along. She looks like a young and beautiful Slokovian." Before Lara had the chance to speak, Lisa let off a shy smile and introduced herself, "It's nice to meet you, Mr. Matthews. My name is Lisa Fraser." Her attitude caused Lara to take a meaningful glance at her. When a woman was looking at what another woman was trying to do, there was a very high possibility that she would be able to see that she clearly had ulterior motives. "Miss Fraser, your dress looks good on you." Seeing that he was a little interested in herself, Lisa lowered her gaze, trying to conceal her glee. "Thank you for the compliment. It was given to me by Miss Reese." Donald's eyes narrowed, and his gaze dimmed slightly. "No matter how pretty the dress is, I won't be able to bring out its glamour anyway." Lara explained immediately and touched her cheek subconsciously, trying to indicate something. Donald has always been an oversensitive and distrustful person. If he were to know that I brought Lisa here with a purpose, I would suffer for it big time. Fortunately, Donald did not ask any more questions. During the meal, Lisa took the initiative to clink glasses with Donald, and Donald seemed to have seen through her thoughts instantly. However, he did not expose and ruin her plan. He had always been fond of young and gorgeous-looking women, so he would not refuse anyone who took the initiative to throw herself at him. Coupled with Lara's disfigured face, Donald's interest in her had steeply decreased compared to before, so he changed his target midway to Lisa instead. After dinner, Donald took Lisa away. Lisa did not expect that this man would take the bait so easily. Thinking that she had successfully gotten herself another chance at climbing up the social ladder, she couldn't care less about Lara. Lara, who was left behind, took out her cell phone and sent a text message to Nala's bodyguard. The next day, at the Victoria College, Daisy and Freya were having lunch in the dining hall. Because of the incident, she had almost blurted something embarrassing when Nolace was around last time. She had been hiding from him for several days. But it was unfortunate for her to run into Nolace and a few of his coursemates in the dining hall. One of the coursemates beside him said something to Nolace and chuckled, and Nolace turned his head and looked in her direction. At that moment, they exchanged gazes, and she instantly lowered her head and continued eating. Freya turned her head to look over at the group of men. "Did the two of you argue again?" She almost choked on her food. "Of course not. It's even worse than that." Nolace walked over and sat next to Daisy. Several of his coursemates laughed at him and made a scene out of the situation. "Ah, he only eats with his girlfriend now." Daisy was only inches away from burying her whole face in her plate, and her ears were flushed. Nolace propped his hand against the side of his forehead and watched as she ate. Daisy could not even eat naturally when he was sitting right next to her and staring at her, so she moved her hand under the table and tried to push him away. However, he grabbed her hand and rubbed his finger against her palm. She trembled from head to toe and wanted to pull her hand away, but she could not. Thus, she turned her head and glared at him. He sounded very earnest and solemn. "Eat your lunch and leave me be." Daisy lowered her voice. How do you expect me to eat like this? Nolé squinted and smiled. He was starting to like to tease her more frequently so that he would get to see her blush. She looked extremely enchanting when she was shy. Chapter 1664. The situation carried on until a figure slammed his silverware on the table. The sound was not thunderous, but it was loud enough to shock everyone at the table. The three of them raised their heads, and Colton had already sat down. Daisy was stunned for a while and quickly withdrew her hand that was under the table. Colton. Colton and Nolase confronted each other with a series of glares. The two of them looked exceptionally unpredictable and unfathomable. Daisy did not dare to say anything at this moment for fear she would say something wrong that would spark a brawl between Colton and Nolase. In the end, it was Nolase who broke the solemn and awkward atmosphere. You rarely come to this dining hall, Colton. Victoria College's dining halls had a wide variety of food, but most of them offered Western food, and the price was slightly lower. In addition to the canteens, there were also restaurants in the college that offered more exotic cuisines. Most of the students came from wealthy families, so they would prefer more exotic and unique delicacies and would choose to eat at more expensive restaurants. As for Colton, he had always stuck to his favorite Eurasian cuisine and rarely came to the dining hall for meals. Colton was expressionless. You come here for lunch, so why can't I be here? Nolase gave off a faint smile. Let's not be too sure about that. Colton still could not get used to Nolase's facade, so he scoffed. I heard that Lisa tried to seduce you the other night. TSK, 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 that scene, I really find it hard to believe. Daisy became nervous subconsciously. Colton. This brat, he's picked the kettle that's boiling now. However, not only did Nolase not get angry, but he also gave off a grin. Are you telling me that you didn't go through the videos that I sent you, not even once? Colton's expression dimmed, and he gnashed his teeth. How can the videos pack the same punch as a first-hand experience? I might at most only need to visit an ophthalmologist after this, but I'm afraid that you'll need a dermatologist and urologist to clear you off. Daisy was confused. What videos are you talking about? Colton and Nolase both responded in unison all of a sudden. It's none of your business. Daisy was rendered speechless. Freya laughed out loud, and the three of them diverted their attention to her. She immediately restrained her smile, went back to being her usual self, and said to Daisy, "It really has nothing to do with you. They re talking about romantic martial arts videos. Why must you interject their conversation?" Daisy complained aggrievedly, "I'm just asking out of curiosity. Who would know which romantic martial arts videos they were talking about?" She replied anxiously, "I've shown them to you, haven't I?" Colton gritted his teeth. "You actually showed her the videos? Have you lost your mind?" Freya raised her eyebrows and laughed. "The videos that you posted are open to the whole college, so why can't Daisy watch them?" Daisy suddenly realized what videos they were talking about, and she was at a loss for words for a moment. She looked at Colton and Nolase, but was unable to look them directly in the eyes, so she picked up her silverware and stood up. Perverts. She then left without looking back. Nolase and Colton glared at Freya, the culprit. She did it on purpose. Daisy walked out of the dining hall, feeling extremely bothered deep down. The two of them actually talked about Lisa's steamy videos when I'm around? All men are indeed perverts. And I didn't expect Colton to be such a person too. She walked by the academic building and ran into Juliana head-on. When Juliana saw her, she was momentarily stunned. She then quickly walked past her with her head lowered. Daisy turned around and stared at the figure that was escaping the scene. As Freya said, Juliana seems to have changed because of Lisa's betrayal. She's become less confident. On the other side of town. When Lisa woke up in the hotel room, Donald had already left. There was a note under the door card on the bedside table. And written on the note was the address of his villa, which meant that he wanted her to move in with him. Lisa was both surprised and happy. She did not expect she would be able to win this man over so easily and live in a huge villa, all thanks to Lara. She walked into the bathroom with a towel on. After freshening herself, she went to the restaurant downstairs, enjoyed the free breakfast offered by the hotel, and then checked out from the hotel. Chapter 1665. As soon as Lisa left the hotel, she received a call from Ivanka. She pursed her lips and tapped on the answer button. Miss Tomlin. Little did she know, a bodyguard hiding in the shadows monitored every move she made. The hazy sky turned dark gradually, and nightfall arrived in the blink of an eye. A black sedan was driving toward the Knowles mansion in a hurry. Knowles leaned on the back seat and scrolled through his phone. The wallpaper that he applied on the screen of his phone was the photo of a mermaid outfit that Daisy wore during the shoot. She lay languidly on the reef, the light reflected off the water and onto her fair skin, and her eyes looked crystal clear and innocent. Such a pair of eyes were scarce in the world. After seeing all kinds of things that the world had to offer and experiencing the coldness of society, it was very easy for one's innocence to be eradicated by their personal growth. Daisy's innocence and simplicity were too precious. They were so precious that he could not help but want to protect these traits forever. He then received a call from his bodyguard halfway through. He picked up the call, and the bodyguard reported that Lisa was indeed at the hotel with Donald last night and that the people supporting her from behind the curtain seemed to have contacted her today. Nala's gaze moved. Have you released the news about Evan? It's been released. It's estimated that the people behind Lisa are aiming at Evan. The other party intends to ensure that Lisa will make it to the top of the pyramid without many obstructions. It seems that the people behind her want to split the profit after helping to get her into the Knowles. It all makes sense now. As long as Lisa can secure her position in a wealthy family, the people behind her who plan everything for her will undoubtedly ask for a piece of the pie. Otherwise, nobody would have tried so hard to help her because a person of no value isn't worth it. Knowles looked out the window. It's time to look into the identity of the person behind her. After finishing the call, Edison took a glance at the rearview mirror and asked after pondering, will Mr. Matthews intervene in this matter? Then you don't know Donald very well either. Knowles raised his head, and his eyes looked as indifferent as always. Donald regards women only as his playthings, and the only trait that he looks for in them is that they refresh to him. Lisa might think that she has found a way out of her despair through Donald, but what she found is only a dead end. I'll bet a hefty amount that Donald didn't even touch her last night. He might have even hired someone else to do it for him. Edison was surprised. But I thought Mr. Matthews never refuses women? Knowles explained calmly, Donald might never refuse women, but it also depends on what kind of woman it is. Apart from being young and beautiful, the women that he seeks, including his three ex-wives, are mostly sexy and hot Western belles. Let's not forget that he strictly upholds the principle of not laying a finger on the women that work on his premises. It's impossible that Donald did not ask someone to look into Lisa's background that night. She might have hinted to him that she's available, but Donald only gave her a chance because they were in Lara's presence. Edison finally understood everything. Donald is only using Lisa to humiliate Miss Reese. Lara was arrogant and had rejected every single invitation that Donald extended back then. To Donald, she was only an item that he wanted but could not get his hands on. Knowles knew Donald as a man. Even though Donald wanted Lara very badly back then, it was only because she was even more difficult to get than other women. He could not keep her for himself, and that had left a scar deep within that itches from time to time. It was also a pity to abandon ship without another try. But now that the Reeses had lost their status in Yarramore, and Lara accepted his invitation only after the disfiguration of her appearance, it was only natural for Donald to feel a little upset. He was never a casual man who would just take any woman in. And now, she no longer had the appearance, the pride, and the personality that appealed to him. He wanted Lara to know that a woman who had been disfigured and had lost her power was no match for a young girl who had nothing. He had lost interest in Lara. If she had not brought Lisa with her last night, she would only have been tortured by Donald. Everything made sense to Edison now. Nolais had spared Lara's life by asking her to deliver the Scourge of the Nulls to Donald. Chapter 1666. Controlling one and working against the other was better than letting two smart women work together and putting Daisy in danger. There wasn't a need for him to do anything to Lisa, because she wouldn't last long. At that moment, Lisa took a cab heading toward the address of the villa written on the note. She hadn't told Ivanka that she was chased out of the Nulls. If she could use that man to turn things around, she would do her best to get out of Ivanka's control. The cab stopped nearby. Lisa looked out the window and saw that it was pitch black around. There wasn't a huge villa as she had imagined, but it was an abandoned construction site. The yellow road lights lit up the way, but everything else was in darkness. She paused and questioned the driver, "Are we at the wrong place?" The driver didn't reply, but suddenly turned off the lights. Lisa realized that she was in danger, so she opened the door and rushed out. After running a few steps, a few men came out from the site and blocked her path. The men dragged her into a lightly lit room. Lisa was slapped across the face because she was crying and struggling, then fell to the ground. She shuddered and saw the men walk closer, her eyes filled with fear. She tried to stop them. "What are you doing?"
I belong to Mr. Donald Matthews.
The leader laughed.
"Belong to Mr. Matthews?
You're funny. Do you really think you slept with him last night?" Lisa's expression froze.
"What do you mean?"
The man walked forward and grabbed her face, then flashed a wide smile. "He doesn't just pick any woman, especially not a prostitute, the woman that the Nulls abandoned. How many men did you sleep with when you were working?" Lisa's face turned pale upon hearing how he was mocking her. She never suspected that the man from last night was Donald. She just thought that she was blindfolded because he had a kink. She wasn't allowed to remove her blindfold the entire time. She never saw Donald until the morning except for keys to a villa and a note with an address. But the truth was, she had no idea with whom she had slept last night. Not only that, they knew everything. The man grabbed her chin and pulled her closer. "I still remember how sultry you looked last night. Why not let my brothers have a taste of that tonight?" Lisa's face was devoid of color in his hand, her eyes dead. The next day, during the weekend. When Daisy woke up, it was already 9:30 a.m. She washed up and went downstairs. Her hair was neatly tied into a bun, and she was wearing a chiffon dress, looking very adorable. She walked into the living room and saw someone sitting on the couch, which surprised her. "You." Nolay sat cross-legged on the couch with a cup of coffee in hand. He looked at her and raised his brows. The housekeeper came out with some tea, then smiled and said, "Morning, ma'am. Your boyfriend has been waiting for you since early this morning. I didn't wake you up because I was worried that you weren't rested enough." Daisy didn't say anything and turned around to run upstairs. After 10 minutes, she came back down. She had changed into a different outfit and combed her hair nicely. She stopped in front of him and asked, "How did you get in?" Nolais put the cup down and smiled. "Your bodyguards let me in because they know that I'm your boyfriend." Daisy's lips twitched. How could the bodyguards that Dad picked have believed him so easily? Chapter 1667. Daisy didn't know that when she had gone to see Nolais, the bodyguards had already recognized him. The housekeeper went in to prepare breakfast. She remembered something and poked her head out to ask, "Have you had something to eat, sir?" Nolais smiled. "Could you please prepare mine too, please?" Daisy was curious. "You haven't had breakfast?" He lazily leaned back. "I just want to get free food here." Daisy put her hands on her hips. "You need to pay for the food." Nolay suddenly held out his hand and pulled her onto his thighs. She was shocked and immediately looked toward the kitchen. The housekeeper was preparing breakfast and didn't notice what was going on in the living room. She nervously lowered her voice. "What are you doing? Didn't you ask for payment?" He pinched her chin and then leaned in. "Here's some interest."
"What interest, MM?" Before she could finish, Nolase kissed her. She stopped breathing, her hand that was on his shoulder tightened, and her lashes fluttered like butterflies. His lips were warm and soft as though he was trying to suck her soul away. Upon remembering that the housekeeper was there, she lightly pushed him away and took deep breaths. I'm going to ignore you. Nolase smiled and ran his finger over her lip. You wouldn't. Daisy was annoyed and bit his finger. He didn't feel anything but stared at the bite mark on his thumb. Bunnies do bite when they're anxious. The housekeeper finished making breakfast and looked into the living room. They had already split up and were seated on the couch as if nothing had happened. Breakfast is ready. Daisy got up first and walked to the dining table. Nolase pulled the chair out next to her, sat down, and handed her a big glass of milk. Drink some. You need it. Daisy immediately understood him, so she hit him. Asshole. The fist that hit him was soft like cotton, as if she was scratching him, so he laughed heartily. The housekeeper turned and looked at the young couple. To her, they were just having fun. The girl made a fuss, and the boy played along. It was beautiful. Nala's phone that was in his pocket buzzed. He took it out and took a look, then put it back. After breakfast, Nolase left. He stopped at the door, turned, and curled his fingers at her. Daisy walked over, but before she could ask, the warmth coming from her lips stunned her. After getting his way, and before she could react, he left. Daisy pressed the back of her hand to her lips. It was still warm. She blushed and mumbled, "How could he run away right after kissing me?" Nolase got into the car, and Edison drove away. Nolase got a call from the bodyguard again on their way. Sir, I found out who's behind her. It was a payday lender named Ivanka Tomlin from Zlokova. The people who work for her are all low-level criminals and have mostly been in jail before. The woman started working early in the night scenes and was once mistress to her boss. She secured her place with the help of her boss, who was in some dodgy business. He was on the wanted list over 10 years ago and was sentenced to 25 years. All the casinos she owns now used to belong to him. She would be nobody without him. Nolase sat with his hand on his chin. Don't underestimate that woman. She wouldn't be where she is if she wasn't ambitious. The bodyguard said, Lisa seems to be tiptoeing around her. Chapter 1668. Can she not tiptoe? Nolase chuckled. Lisa got to where she was because of Ivanka. If Ivanka wanted to use her, she would have planned to control her. If she knew that Lisa was planning to ditch her, no matter where she would go, she would be blocked. When Lisa fell into the hands of Donald's people, and once she realized that she had nowhere else to go, Ivanka would be her way out. If she cut Ivanka off, it would be the end of her. Edison looked into the rearview mirror. He had never been disappointed with Nolase's tactics during all the years that he had worked for him. Even Donald had told the people in the black market that the Knowles kid was a wolf, and if he offended him now, he might bite him in the future. If that didn't kill him, he would still need to pay with a pound of flesh. Lisa was just a clown to him. She kept challenging Nolase, so it would be weird if he let her off. Meanwhile, when Lisa woke up, she was in a hospital. The construction site workers had found her in the morning, and she was barely holding on while covered in blood from head to toe. The nurse came in and saw that she was awake. Did something happen to you? We can make a police report on your behalf. Lisa wanted to say something when a few men entered. Donald followed them with a smile. Ma'am, sorry for causing trouble. He handed her a name card. She took it over, and her hand shook when she saw the name. Mr. Matthews. Donald patted her shoulder and looked friendly. How is she? The nurse couldn't stop shaking and looked pale, tearing, severe infection. She will need a urine bag for a while. Oh. Donald sat down at the edge of the bed and patted the back of her hand, still having a smile on his face, which looked creepy. Take a good rest then. You need to get back to work once you're feeling better. Lisa was mortified with her experience from the previous night. Her voice was hoarse when she started crying. I'm sorry. Please let me go. What are you talking about?
Donald leaned in. He heard it, but pretended not to hear it as a warning. Lisa ground her teeth. She had to give herself a chance to survive. It was Lara's idea. She wanted to introduce me to you.
Donald squinted, then asked a man to come over.
The man stood behind him with his head hanging low. Donald grabbed him by his collar and asked with a smile, what did they do?
They'd broken her, and now I have to clean this up?
They were most afraid when Donald smiled. The man took a gulp.
I'm sorry, sir, it was my fault.
I'll remind them the next time.
There won't be a next time. Mr. Livingston from Hanniston will be coming to Yarramore for a while.
Once she recovers, send her over to serve him, you got that?
Donald smoothened his collar.
The man nodded.
Yes, sir.
Donald turned to look at her. Take care of your health and help me make some money.
I'll treat you right.
He got up and left the room with his men. Lisa cried quietly while holding the bed sheets tight.
How did it get to this?
That isn't fair.
Why do I have to be treated so cruelly?
She held out a hand to get the phone on the table and called Ivanka at the Victoria Business College's library. Daisy stood in front of the racks looking for reference books about performance. She looked up and saw that the book was kept high up, so she had to stand on her toes to get it. Chapter 1669. Before Daisy could touch it, someone took it from behind.
Are you looking for this?
Daisy turned around and was surprised. The man behind her had healthy tan skin and looked slightly Middle Eastern. He had black curly hair, beautiful features, deep-set eyes, and light pupils. He looked unique. But most importantly, he looked familiar. The man smiled and showed off his white teeth. Don't you remember me?
We were in a perfume ad once.
Daisy was shocked.
It's you?
She took a closer look, and his features matched the young model she had worked with. He nodded, then handed the book to her. I'm Ian. Daisy took the book from him and asked, are you a student here too?
I've never seen you in the drama, theater, and film classes.
I'm not a student in that course.
Ian looked at her and smiled.
To be exact, I'm from the art school.
The Royal College of Victoria was split into the business side and the art side.
The art course was huge, so it was upgraded into a school.
It was normal that she hadn't met everyone in college even till then.
Daisy, have you found your books?
Freya, who was waiting for her, walked over.
Daisy leaned on the rack and squinted.
I was wondering why you were taking so long.
Turns out there's a man here.
Daisy choked.
Nonsense.
We were in the perfume ad and bumped into each other here.
She looked at Ian and waved the book in her hand. Thanks for this.
We have plans, so we need to leave now.
See you later.
Ian smiled and nodded.
Sure.
Daisy left with Freya.
After leaving the library, Freya suddenly laughed.
You were in an ad campaign with Ian Harris?
Daisy paused.
You know who he is?
He is the face of the art school, a walking sculpture.
Just go see the work of the art school, and you'll understand.
Even though Daisy wasn't from the art school, she understood what walking sculpture meant.
When the art students painted people, they needed models. The more unique they looked, handsome, athletic ones would be preferred among the students, and that was why Freya said that he was the face of the art school.
Daisy hesitated and asked, shyly, do you mean nude paintings?
Freya choked on her saliva and coughed into her hand, then cried, laughing, do you want to take a look?
I never said that.
Freya put her hand on her shoulder and laughed.
If you want to take a look, just look at Nolace.
I believe he would be happy about it.
She suddenly blushed.
No, don't put ideas in my head.
There's no need for that.
Freya saw through her.
Women are hornier than men.
Would you say you never thought about Nolace that way?
Daisy immediately avoided eye contact.
Freya leaned in closer.
You have a handsome and charming boyfriend who people drool over.
Are you not going to take a bite? Daisy's face started burning.
Don't tease me.
Freya laughed.
I don't think you'll be able to contain yourself if another woman like Lisa starts showing up around him.
Chapter 1670. Daisy pressed her lips together and stayed silent.
It would be a lie to say that she never thought about Nolace that way.
How could someone not when they saw a face like that?
Freya waved her hand.
All right, enough from me.
I don't want you to have funny dreams.
Daisy covered her mouth.
Enough.
Ian stood at the walkway to the library and watched them leave, then turned and left too.
At the Knowles group,
there was a knock on the door.
Edison opened it and saw Tristan walk into the office.
Nolace. Nolace closed the file he was holding and looked up.
You're back.
I heard that Donald Matthews has Lisa now.
Tristan pulled a chair out and sat down.
Nolace, are you in contact with him?
Nolace put down the file.
No, I just went through Lara.
Tristan frowned.
Jonah Rhys has taken her out of the hospital to avoid Donald.
You used Lara to send Lisa to Donald.
If Lara said that it was you,
she wouldn't.
Nolay smiled.
Lara knows that she has offended Donald, so she threw Lisa under the bus to protect herself.
If she didn't do that, we wouldn't know if Jonah would ever see his daughter again.
Lara was arrogant in the past, and now that she had learned her lesson, and Donald was no longer someone she could go against, if she continued to do whatever she wanted, even if she was still oblivious, Jonah wouldn't be.
Have you found out who's behind Lisa? Asked Tristan.
Yes, they planned your accident.
Tristan handed him a document.
Lisa got into our family, and they both would benefit if she got what she wanted.
Tristan looked through the file, and his face turned dark.
After so many years of living, he had been tricked by a young girl who looked innocent.
If it weren't for Nolace, he would have been played till the end.
Soon after Tristan left, Nolace received a text.
After he read the content, he frowned.
That evening,
Daisy stood outside the college, waiting for her ride.
They were stuck in a jam.
She bumped into Ian standing among the crowd, but he stood out.
He saw Daisy and said something to his friend next to him before walking over.
Are you waiting for someone?
She smiled.
Yes.
I guess there's a traffic jam.
Ian looked annoyed. I've been waiting for quite some time too.
Daisy saw her ride arriving, so she turned around and said out of the kindness of her heart, where do you leave?
Do you want to hop into my car?
Ian paused.
Would it be inconvenient?
Not at all.
He smiled.
What I meant was, would your boyfriend mind?
Daisy paused because he thought he didn't want Nolace to have the wrong idea, so she smiled.
My bodyguard is picking me up.
Daisy let the bodyguards send Ian back first.
He lived in the city, and they were passing by.
Thanks for sending me.
Ian was grateful.
Daisy waved her hand.
Don't worry about it.
It was on the way.
You girls from Zlokova are all so kind.
Ian looked at her.
I heard that Zlokova is a lot richer than my country and has a lot of land and resources.
I would like to visit it one day.
Where are you from?
It's a country in Southwest Eurasia.
But my parents moved to Yaromor when I was a kid.
Daisy suddenly understood.
Oh, that's why you're unique.